In many applications, the shortest path problem is applied on a network where all the costs are non-negative. Think about travel time, length, all these quantities are non-negative. In that case, the shortest path algorithm can be made more efficient. In particular, we can show that each node will be treated at most once. This version of the algorithm is called Dijkstra's algorithm, from the name of a Dutch researcher. There are two differences between the generic shortest path algorithm that we have seen before and this version, which we'll call Dijkstra's algorithm. First, we assume that there is no negative cost in the network. As a consequence, there will be no cycle with negative cost. It means that in the algorithm, there will be no need to check if the problem is unbounded. So this will be one simplification. The second modification provides a specific rule for the choice of the node that is treated at each iteration. Actually, we didn't specify any rule in the generic shortest path algorithm. We just said, select one node in S and proceed. In this case, we will select the node in S which is associated with the smallest label. Dijkstra's algorithm is the same as the shortest path algorithm, including these two modifications. So we initialize the labels to 0 for the origin and plus infinity to all over nodes, and the set of nodes is initialized with the origin node. Then at each iteration, we choose a node in S such that its label is less than any other label in the set. Then we treat the node, meaning that for each outgoing arc, we check if the optimality condition is verified. If not, we update the label and we add the node in the set of nodes. Once all the arcs have been visited, we remove the node from the set of nodes and we stop the iteration as soon as this set of nodes is empty. The main property of this algorithm is that once a label has been set, it's not modified anymore. And this is what we will prove now. Let's call T the set of nodes such that the label has been set, so it is not infinity, and the node is not in the set S of nodes to be processed. And I want to show that this set is a set of permanent labels. It means that the labels will not be updated anymore by the algorithm. Let's introduce some properties of the algorithm that hold at the end of each iteration. The first property says that if a node is in T, its label will be less or equal to the label of any node which is not in T. And we will show this by induction. At the first iteration, O is the only node which is treated. It is treated by looking at a node going arc that goes to, let's say, J. This cost is COJ. We know that lambda O is equal to 0 by initialization. And during the first iteration, the label of J, which was plus infinity, will become COJ. After the first iteration, O will be removed from S, so it will belong to T, and J will be included in S, so J will not be in T. And we have indeed that the label of J, which is now COJ, is greater than the label of O, which is 0. And this is true because we have a network with non-negative costs. So this holds at the first iteration. So now let's consider iteration treating node L. So at the beginning of the iteration, L belongs to S, so L does not belong to T. And we assume that at the beginning of the iteration, by induction assumption, the property holds. So because L does not belong to T, its label is bigger than any label in T. Let's draw the set T, and we have the node L, which is here. So two things can happen. One is that one arc goes to a node M, which is inside T during the iteration. In that case, we know that lambda m is less or equal to lambda l because of this property and, by induction. Now, what is the algorithm doing? It's checking that lambda m is less or equal to lambda l plus c lm. And because the cost is non-negative, this is verified. It means that during one iteration, no node in T will be updated because this condition will always be verified. And this is actually the next property that we will see in the next slide. Now let's assume that the iteration now treats an arc that goes to a node P, which is not in T. Two things can happen. Either lambda P is less or equal to lambda L plus CLP. Well, in that case, the algorithm will not do anything. And all the labels will be the same. There is no modification. So whatever property was holding before, it will hold afterwards. Now, if lambda P is strictly greater than lambda L plus CLP, then the algorithm will set lambda P to lambda L plus CLP. This is this statement here. It means that lambda P takes a value which is larger than the value of lambda L, again, because the cost is non-negative. And by the assumption of the induction, we know that lambda L is larger than any node in T. And because lambda P is even larger, the property holds for lambda P as well. Okay, so in that case, when we have an arc from a node outside T to a node outside T, either the label is not updated and everything is fine, and if the label is updated, it would be updated to a value which is larger than lambda L, and the property will continue to hold. Now, at the end of the iteration, once we have processed all the arcs, lambda L will be moved into T. It will go out of S. And this is where the rule for the choice of the label is important. Indeed, because we have chosen lambda L to have the smallest label amongst everything which is not in T, once it goes into T, well, it will be less or equal to any value out of T, which proves the result. So the next property has been actually presented in the previous property. If a node is in the set T at the beginning of the iteration, then its label is not modified during the iteration. This is a corollary of the previous property because all the labels inside T actually verify the optimality condition already. As a direct consequence, because no label in T is updated, it means that they will not be added to S, because only labels that are updated here will be added to S. So if a node is in T at the beginning of the iteration, then it will not be in S at the end of the iteration. And the last property justifies the name permanent labels for the set T. At the end of each iteration, if I belongs to T, then lambda I is the length of a shortest path from node O to node I. And this is due to the fact that the label is permanent. So because this value will stay the same until the end of the algorithm, and that we know from the shortest path algorithm that at the end, each label can be interpreted as the length of the shortest path. In this case, it's already the case at the current iteration because the label will not be modified anymore. Dijkstra's algorithm is the generic shortest path algorithm with two modifications. One, we assume that all the costs in the network are non-negative. Two, we add a rule to decide which node to be processed. Among all the candidates to be processed at a given iteration, we select the one with minimum label. In that case, the algorithm has the property that each label becomes permanent once it is set. As a consequence, each node will be treated at most once during the whole course of the algorithm.